Good morning, Mosaic. That was nice. Welcome this morning. Got to put my specs on. I want to read to you out of, we'll go back one. It says, "Shout joyfully to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful singing." Are you ready this morning?
Yes.
Are you happy? Is it good to be in the house of God? Yeah, that's good to know. "Come before him with joyful singing. Know that the Lord himself is God. It is he who has made us and not we ourselves. And we are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name. For the Lord is good. His loving kindness is everlasting and his faithfulness to all generations." He has been a good God to each one of us, hasn't he? We are a bunch of broken pieces, as Tony talks about, coming together to celebrate and to worship this morning the risen Savior and our Father God. As we join this morning in worship with Matt and his team, let's stand up and we'll gather with them and join together in prayer first. Let's pray. Father, we thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to gather again and to worship you and to praise you. It is good to be in your house, Father, and to worship together as family. Lord, take our broken pieces and mold us and make us together, Lord, into an image that is pleasing to you. And Lord, accept our worship this morning. And Father, we invite your power, your presence, and your anointing to be here. Lord, we give it to you, and we say, have your way this morning with us all. Be happy with our worship and our praise this morning. We love you, Lord, and we give you praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Message to just sink in for us. What we just sang, I wrote it down, right? I want to speak it over us. He has overcome. We will not fear. We will rejoice. Because why? Because greater is he that is us. Greater is he that is in us than he that's in the world. Wow. Let me just pray that for us. Let's just pray. God, thanks for the morning, a chance to be in this place, to lift our hearts in one accord, God, to have our hearts unified around the things of Jesus Christ is a cool deal. And so I pray that as we go through the rest of our morning, God, I pray for Ken as he shares his heart with us. We pray for Tony, who's home sick. God, we ask you might just restore him. He's just really been battling it this early part of the winter, and we pray you would just heal him, God. Just give him back his strength. Thanks for Ken, and to speak through him. I pray this morning, God, that you would help us take captive our thoughts and make them obedient to Jesus Christ. I pray that as a church, we cry out in one voice that greater is he that is in us than he's in the world. And so we love you and we give you the entire morning, God. We celebrate this day, your faithfulness to us. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. Hey, before you sit down, say, somebody sitting by you, you sound great when you sing. I like you being in my row.
It's your house.
A tardy pass? Go to the office. All right, good morning. My name is Dan. To some others, it's Mr. Jones. All right, but what I want to do is draw your attention to the pew back. There should be a pamphlet in there that says things you may want to know. What that does is it has different ministries going on within the church that you may be interested in. So if you're new, visiting, if you've been going here a while and you really want to start getting involved, take a look at that. And then that leads me to the next thing, the connection card. On the connection card, you're able to communicate with us about prayer requests, different areas you'd like to maybe start to serve in. It's also a great way for you to keep us updated on your information, address, email, things like that, so that we can make sure we're staying in touch with you. We have the giving boxes. If you would, you can always drop your tithes and connection cards in those, and those are located in the back. Next Saturday is our women's second Saturday open Bible study. That is going to be December 12th at 9 a.m. It'll be in room 303. There's no need to register. All ladies are welcome. And immediately following the women's Bible study will be praise moves. So, and that will start at 10:35, and that goes to 11:30. So, and that also is in Fellowship Hall for any women who are planning to attend. Our monthly newsletter, Mosaic Monthly Happenings, will be going out this week. So please watch for that in your email. If you're not seeing it in your email, that's a great indication that we need some updated information from you. So going back to the connection card, please make sure that your email is there as well. Next, our food pantry breakfast will be Wednesday, December 16th from 8:30 to 11. So if you're interested in serving, again, not to place more emphasis on the connection card, but please mark it on the connection card so that we know that you'll be helping out. All right, Christmas Eve service, in case you're wondering, is on December 24th. It will be, there'll be three different services. We'll have a service at 5, a service at 7, and then we're going to have a candlelight service at 11. Child care will not be provided because they should all be in bed. No, I'm just kidding. They should be worshiping with you. It's an opportunity for you to really worship with your children. So please make sure to bring them along. 11 o'clock, maybe they should be in bed. I don't know. But that's all I've got for tonight. So, or today. So, Ken?
Thanks, Dan. Morning, Mosaic. Honor and a privilege to be before you again. Always short notice with Tony, you know. Never a long length of time to prepare, but it's good. Stretches me. You know, it's real easy when he asks me. It's like, oh, I want to go back and, you know, something that I've already studied, something that I already know. Just pull the ace out of my sleeve. Oh, this is God really revealed this special. You know, he's like, no, it's not about you. And don't feed him leftovers. Feed him something fresh. So, it might seem like leftovers because I'm going to be right where Tony's at. I'm just going to honor him. He feels the Lord led him to be in Ephesians to feed this flock. Who am I to take us away from it? So I'm going to go over a lot that he's already went over. I'm certainly not going to improve it. It's just going to be from a different perspective. That's all. God speaks to us in different ways. You know, just you look through the Gospels, just how the stories were told from a different perspective. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John were different. So I'm going to go over this, just what he's been teaching on. And I just want to take a minute before we start, just remind us just to pray. Pray for our pastors. Pray for our staff. Man, I've never been in the ministry, in vocational ministry, but I know there's a lot of weight that goes with it. And it's stuff that we don't see, that we don't understand. You don't understand the pressures of ministry and the unrealistic expectations that get put on our pastors. We need to cover them in prayer. That's our job. So this is a reminder for me too. When I see Tony being sick and ill, it's because he's wore out. Because he's tired. We need to lift him up. We need to pray for them. We need to pray for protection of marriages, for Matt, for Rad, all of our staff. We're in warfare. It's real. It's spiritual warfare, and we need to fight for them in the heavenly realms. So I just challenge us to do that. So we'll be in Ephesians 1. We're going to focus in on Ephesians chapter 1, verses 1 through 7. I'm going to open in prayer, and then we'll start. Father, we just, God, I just humbly come before you, Lord. God, not out of routine or ritual, but out of desperation, Lord, that you would just come and fall fresh here right now. Lord, I just pray that you would just do what only you can do, that only your Holy Spirit can minister to these souls. God, I have no clue on what it is that they need, but you do. So God, I just pray you just do a miraculous work with your word and minister to every soul, every spirit that's in this place, Lord. I just pray that you would just plow through hearts. God, I pray you'd cast down strongholds that and lies that have been taught or that we've believed or that we've set up ourselves in our mind and in our heart, God, that are against you, that are not true, and that you would replace them with the truth of who we are in you and who you are, God. God, instill in us the truth. Remind us of who we are and how much we're loved. And we'll just give you the praise and the glory in Jesus' name, amen. All right, Ephesians 1, 1 through 7. Just going to read. That's all, you know, Lord willing, I think that's all we're going to be able to cover at the most. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, to the saints in Ephesus, the faithful in Christ Jesus, grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. For he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us to be adopted as his sons through Jesus Christ, in accordance with his pleasure and will, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us in the one he loves. In him we have redemption through the blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he lavished on us with all wisdom and understanding. So let's start at the top. Paul. Tony, a few weeks ago, just gave a great background on who Paul was, how he was Saul, and how God had an encounter with him on the Damascus Road, and the transformation that came upon him, that he was called, he was sent to minister the gospel to the Gentiles, to the Gentiles. So he was called and chosen by God. But he was an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God. By the will of God. Anytime I read that, it strikes me. By the will of God. So many times I wonder, like, how many times do you ask yourself, what's God's will for me? What's God's will for me? Paul knew that it was God's will for him to be an apostle. Sometimes I wonder if I'm in the will of God. Am I living in the will of God? How do I know? Guys that are in men's group, they know where I'm going. As soon as I say this, I say the same thing over and over. I just quote the same scripture. 1 Thessalonians 5, 16, 17, and 18. Be joyful always. Pray continually. Give thanks in all circumstances. For this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. That's how I know if I'm in God's will. That's a good place to start. Am I joyful? Am I prayerful? And am I thankful? It doesn't have anything to do with the circumstances. It has to do with my heart. That's how I know if I'm in God's will. Joyful, prayerful, thankful. Start there. That's hard. But Paul was an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God. Not by Paul's choosing, not because Paul wanted to, not because Paul went to school to get to be able to do it, not because Paul worked his way up to it. It's because God said so. That's why I'm here. I didn't ask for this. I didn't necessarily desire this. I'm not someone that a man would choose. Tony wouldn't choose. God moved. God put me here for this reason. Today or this moment for some reason. I have no idea why. Why would he use me? I know the people that go here. A lot of people that are a lot more articulate, a lot smarter, a lot more qualified than what I am. But for some reason, he chose me. But sometimes we want to run from that. Paul didn't run from it, especially when circumstances get hard. Things get hard. It gets hard. I get afraid. Then I want to flee from it. I don't want to do it. Paul probably didn't want to do it. There's been times in my life where I've really struggled. It's been in a dark place. Things seem to keep going wrong and wrong over and over again. One thing after another, one thing after another. And I'll be in a group and I'll just be offering for prayer and I'll just ask them to pray for these things. And some people are just like, well, hey, you know, maybe you're just not in God's will. Maybe. But maybe I'm downtown right in God's will when life's falling apart. You know, sometimes, yeah, there's circumstances where I make bad choices, make foolish decisions, and then I have to, you know, there's consequences to pay for that. So, yeah, I'm not in God's will. I sinned or I did something that I shouldn't do, so now, you know, my life's falling apart. Other times, Paul was right in God's will. And things weren't always good for Paul. I'm going to read, he just kind of gives a list here in the Corinthians, in 2 Corinthians 11, you don't have to go there, starting in verse 24, 2 Corinthians 11, verse 24, it says, five times I received from the Jews the 40 lashes minus one. Three times I was beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. Three times I was shipwrecked. I spent a night and a day in the open sea. I have been constantly on the move. I've been in danger from rivers and dangers from bandits and dangers from my own countrymen and dangers from Gentiles and dangers in the city and dangers in the country and dangers at sea and dangers from false brothers. I have labored and toiled and have often gone without sleep. I have known hunger and thirst and I have often gone without food. I have been cold and naked. Besides all this, I face daily the pressure of my concern for all the churches. He's right downtown God's will and he's getting beat, shipwrecked, naked, hungry. So if things are falling apart in your life, don't necessarily believe that you're not in God's will. Maybe that's exactly where he wants you. Because he's really not concerned. Just being in God's will doesn't mean everything's going to be great on the earth. Because that's really not his will. His concern isn't about what this is temporal. This is a vapor. His concern is about eternity. And he's going to do things in our life that on earth that are going to continue to work us and shape us and mold us into the image of Jesus. Because that's his purpose. That's his will for us, is that we become like him. And it seems like the harder we are, the more work he's got to do. You know, if you're clay and you're soft, he's just going to mold you and shape you. If you're, you know, if you're a piece of steel, you're going to be on a grinding wheel. And there's going to be sparks flying. But he can shape you and use you and make you into something really powerful. But it's not going to be fun in the process. Just remember that. If you're a piece of granite, he's going to chip and chip and chip and chip until he makes this beautiful sculpture. He's doing his will in you, but it's not doing it the way that we would think that he would, or necessarily the way that we would want him to. I mean, I just think about how Tony went back and how he spoke about David being chosen. David was chosen. He was going to be the king. But what did David have to go through until he got there? It wasn't all glory and happy. Oh, I'm right in God's will. This is awesome. No. He was fleeing for his life. Anyone God, I mean, if you're going to be used greatly in God, you're going to be, he's going to crush you first. I think that's Tozer that says that. Any man that God would use greatly, he will crush him first. In this world, we will have trouble. In this life, we will have pain. But he has overcome. Greater is he that's in us than he that's in the world. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the will of God. And by the will of God, this isn't what will, the will of God is not what he demands. The will of God is what brings him pleasure. It's what brings him joy. He doesn't force that on us. It's what he desires for us. And like I said, and it's not about what our circumstances. It's about what he's doing in them. So Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, to the saints in Ephesus, the faithful in Christ Jesus. So he's writing to the saints in Ephesus. He's writing to the church, to the believers in the church at Ephesus. So it's written to them, but it's written for us. You know, we're part of the body. We're just as much part of the body as what they are. We believe in the same Jesus. We believe in the same God. We worship the same one. So although this is written to them, it's written for us. We can get something out of this. This is for us. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, to the saints in Ephesus, the faithful in Christ Jesus, the believers, the believers. Verse 3, grace and peace to you from God our Father and Lord Jesus Christ. Grace and peace. Amen. That's only true grace and true peace comes from God through Jesus. And I said this last service that, you know, I'm not big on these acronyms. Sometimes I think they're corny and they're cheesy. But grace, I've heard this one, that's God's riches at Christ's expense. It's corny, it's cheesy, but it's true. It's all of God's blessings given to us, but Christ had to pay the price for it. Freely given, favor given to us only through God or through God's people. Tony talked about that last week about being gracious. That if we're like Jesus, if we're his children, we should be gracious. Not that we have the ability to give grace, but that we should be gracious to others. I've experienced grace through God and through his believers. That's the only time I've ever experienced grace. It's either him or his believers, people that know him. Grace and peace. Once we experience that grace, peace. You know, in Romans 5, it talks about the peace with God when it's through faith. When we believe what God's done for us and recognize that, we have peace with God.
No longer against peace with him. But there's also a peace of God. So there's peace with God through faith. Peace of God comes from prayer. That's part of that being in His will, joyful, prayerful, thankful. If you want the peace of God to come upon you, you pray. That's what I did. I did a lot of praying before I got here. I get anxious, I get worried, I get fearful. It's like, I need the peace of God to come rest on me. I need to get out of my body, out of the flesh. Walk in the Spirit. If you want that, you got to pray. And when you pray, blessings come. Because when you pray, and you're praying in your closet, you're never faking it when you're praying to God in your closet by yourself. I never fake it. Never have to. I don't have to make my words sound good for Him. In a group, you might try to fake it, try to make it sound good. When you're praying on your knees and crying out to God in your closet, there's no pride involved. It's just faith. And when you pray in faith, His peace comes upon you. So it's grace and peace. It's the things that He does for us as believers. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Even Jesus said, peace I give you, not as the world gives. Now, I've been at peace sometimes, and my peace came out of my ignorance. Just because I didn't know. But there's a peace from God that surpasses all of us. And you know it when you got it. You know it. Because God's in your circumstances. Just like Paul, he's in prison. He's chained in a dungeon. This isn't like prison today. He's not watching cable TV and stuff. He's chained in a dungeon, and it's not his sentence. His life is in the balance. He's waiting for a sentence for being in the will of God. And what is he focused on? Is he focused on, oh, me, oh, all these beings, oh, all these things that are going on? No. It doesn't even cross his mind. He's saying that I'm in the will of God. Grace and peace. Thinking about the brothers and sisters in Christ.
His heart and his thoughts are with them, not about himself. And what's he turn around and do? Praises God. Praises Him. Praises Him. In the midst of His suffering, in the midst of His... Man, that's convicting to me. When things start going wrong in my life, I start thinking about me. Oh, how pity me. Oh, me. Oh, me. Oh, me. Not Paul. How good is God? And what about everybody else? What a great model. What a great model. How challenging, convicting to me. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Praise Him to God the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms. All right, Tony talked about that last week, blessed, that this blessing. And then Tony said that it meant to be spoken well of. You know, when I said this last thing. Anytime Tony teaches me something, I go home and check it out. Not because I don't believe him, but because that's what God tells us to do. We're to be like Bereans. We're to go and set whoever's up here teaching, whatever I'm saying, you should be checking it out and making sure it's right. Don't just take my word because I'm standing up here. You check it out. And I checked it out, and Tony's been right every time that I've checked it out, but I still check it out. Because God speaks to me through that, and then he gives me other questions, and then I got to go back to Tony and ask him about this or that or whatever. And I grow. That's how I grow. But yes, it means to be spoken well of. This is exactly what it means. We get our word eulogy out of it. And it's always troubled me. Whenever I go to a funeral, all these people stand up. I mean, they line up and come and say nice things about the person that's passed. I'm like, wow, I wonder if any of them said that to them ever when they were alive. It always troubles me. It's like, why do we wait till you're gone to go say nice things about you? But God's doing it to us now. He says he's blessed us in the heavenly realms. He's speaking well of us. God speaks well of us as his children. Sometimes I don't get that. Sometimes I don't think that he does. Sometimes I don't think he's pleased with me when he sees what I do, or he sees how I think, or he sees how I act. Like, I doubt if he's speaking very well of me. But it says he is. He says he speaks well of me. He has blessed us in the heavenly realms. When Tony read that, I was like, the heavenly realms. You know, I kind of got stuck on that. Like, what's the heavenly realm? Is it in heaven? He's blessing me in heaven? He's saying nice things about me in heaven? Well, I'm not in heaven. Why is he saying nice things about me there? What good is that for me now? But I studied it, or I looked it up, and it's an adjective. It's not a place. The heavenly realms is an adjective. It's used to describe someplace. And, you know, I don't know Greek. I can't pronounce it. I'll look like a fool. I don't care. Epiraneos? I don't know. It's 2032 in Strong's, if you want to look it up. It means The meaning is the sphere of spiritual activities. So it's the spiritual realm. We live in the physical realm. There's this, and it's real, and we see it. But there's also a spiritual realm that's real. We just don't see it. But this is where he's speaking blessings on us or over us, or he's talking well of us in the spiritual realm. So I found it interesting. He's speaking well of us in the spiritual realm. And then I looked in the concordance and looked, did more study, and I found that Paul is the only one that uses this phrase, spiritual realm. And he uses it only in the book of Ephesians. And he uses it 5 times. And so, of course, I got to go read, you know, I've turned into a nerd somehow, that I just can't stop reading. I just want to figure this stuff out. I've never studied this hard in school, ever. My teachers would be amazed. Like, he's reading? I never read a book in high school. Cliff Notes back in the day. But I can't get enough of it. When he reveals that to me, then I'm like, I need to read this where it says, where else it says. So we're going to skip over to start in verse 15. It's really verse 20 is where I want to get, but like Tony says, I want to keep it in context. This is Paul praying over these believers. This is Paul praying for, he's listing all the things that we are in Christ and what Christ has done for us. And now he's going to start giving thanks to God and to the people. He says, for this reason, because of all the things God's done, ever since I heard about your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, the Ephesian church, and your love for all the saints, your love for one another, your unity, I have not stopped giving thanks for you, remembering you in my prayer. Giving thanks and praying. Remember what I said about God's will? Being joyful, prayerful, thankful? Here's Paul living it out. He's being joyful in prison, praising God. He's thanking him for what his friends, his church, the body, and he's praying for him. He's being joyful, thankful, and prayful. He's in God's will. He is in God's will, living it out. And hey, if you want to know how to pray for me, pray this for me. Pray 17 and 18 for me. It's a great prayer. I pray this over my children every day. Every day. First thing in the morning, I'm praying this. I'm praying Ephesians 1, Paul's prayer, and I'm praying Ephesians 3, Paul's prayer, over my children. Every day. You don't know how to pray? I don't know what to say. I don't know how to do it. Pray though. I don't know how to pray either. I'm not very good at it. Don't have the words. Not that smart. Don't know how to word it. I just steal Paul's because they're good. And they work. It's there for a reason. I keep asking that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that you may know him better. That's God's will. God wants you to know him better. I want people, you're going to pray for me, pray that over me. I want to know him better. I want to know Jesus more. I want to see him. I want revelation. I want wisdom so that I can know Jesus better and be more like him. That's what I want for my children. That's what I want for my grandchildren. That's what I want for my wife. That's what I want for all the people that I love. Great prayer here. If you don't walk away with anything else, walk away with that, praying this tomorrow or today. I keep asking that God, our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that you may know him better. I pray also that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he's called you. You have to know the hope that he's called you. The riches of his glorious inheritance to the saints. The richness of what it is that he's done and given us. And his incomparable great power for us who believe. There's this great power that he's given us. The power that lives in us. It's greater than the world that we were just singing about. This is where it is, right here. His incredible great power for us who believe. The power is like the working of his mighty strength, which he exerted in Christ when he raised him from the dead. The same power that raised Jesus from the dead lives in me, lives in you. If you know Jesus, that's a power, a dynamite power. That power is like the working of the mighty strength which he exerted in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at the right hand in the heavenly realms. Seated him at the right hand in the heavenly realms. So Jesus is in the heavenly realms. Remember we talked about how he's blessing us, speaking, God, Father, is speaking well of us in the heavenly realms. Jesus is sitting at the right hand in the heavenly realms. Jesus is there. Father God's there. Find that interesting. Keep reading. Far above all rule and authority. So Jesus is sitting on a throne in the spiritual realm above all authority, all power, all dominion, and every title that can be given, not only in this present age, but also in the one to come. He's head over everything. Jesus is head over it all in the spiritual realm, and God's there with him. And God placed all things under his feet and appointed him to be head over everything of the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills everything in every way. Now, I'm just going to keep reading because I want to get to 2:6, but I want to keep it in context. I don't want to jump around just to make it clear. Chapter 2, verse 1. As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins. Absolutely, every one of us were. We were dead at one time. In which we used to live when you were followed the ways of the world and all the rulers of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are being disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our sinful nature and following the desires and its thoughts. Absolutely, it hits home with me. Like the rest, we were by nature objects of wrath. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ even when we were dead in transgression. Praise God. It is by grace that you've been saved. And then here's the kicker. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms. We're there. I was like, why are you saying nice things about me? I'm not even there. I am there. I'm seated there. You can't see it. It's in the spiritual. It's not in the physical realm. But we're there. And it's real. And God the Father's there. Jesus is there. And God's saying nice things about me. That's pretty awesome. That's my position. That's who I am. That's where I'm at. I forget that. I'm exalted with Jesus. God's speaking nice things about me. I forget about that. I forget about that. But guess what? It's not all glory and great all the time. Flip back to Ephesians 6. This is Ephesians is a great book of doctrine. It teaches us who we are and what we are in Christ. And then because of that, it tells us how we should act and how we should be unified and how we're supposed to love one another, how we're supposed to treat our wives, how we're supposed to treat our husbands, all those things. And then it comes down here to the end and it says, finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. In his mighty power, that power that raised Jesus from the dead that's in us, be strong. That's where our strength comes from, in that power that he's given us. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take up your stand against the devil's scheme. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. There's a battle going on. It's real. It's in the heavenly realms. And it's not against people. I forget that. When someone has an issue with me, or I have a conflict at work, or conflict with my family, I'm attacking the person. I think that my issue is with them. My issue isn't with them. It's in the spiritual realm. It's the enemy trying to make me fall, to ruin my witness, to make me walk in the flesh. But when I walk in the spirit, when I take that power that God's given me, I win. Because remember, you go back to Ephesians 1:20, it says that Jesus was setting up at the right hand of the Father, far above all rule, authority, power, and dominion. He's already above it. The war's been won. The battle rages. We're engaged, but he's given us the power. We're fighting in victory. I forget that sometimes. When I look around the world, when you look at, like Rad was saying, the news and everything else, issues that are going on in my life and with my kids and with bad things, you know, just stuff. Health, I mean, you guys know. I don't have to tell you, you know, because you're experiencing it right now. But he is overcome. In this life, we will have trouble. And this just blew me away. When he sang this last night, I only knew, not very long, you know, I knew on Friday that I was going to teach. These songs were picked out long before that. And he started singing that. I just about wept. How it tied into with what God was speaking to me in the Word. And to think that I wanted to go and do something that he talked to me about long ago, that I was more confident in. God's will. But this is who we are. This is our position and who he is. We're in the heavenly realm. We've been blessed. He's blessed us and he speaks well of us. Remember that. It's important. It has nothing to do with you. Okay? It has something to do with Jesus. These are believers in Jesus. You see this repeated, I don't know how many times in Ephesians 1. In Christ, in Christ, in Christ, in Christ, in Christ. It isn't about us. It's about Christ. about us being in him. Praise be to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realm, spoken well of us in the spiritual realm, with every spiritual blessing in Christ. Every spiritual blessing. So when I, like, spiritual blessing, what's the spiritual blessing? Okay, so then I flip it around. I think blessings of the Spirit, maybe. Fruits of the Spirit. No, it didn't set well. No, that's not, I don't think that's what he means. But I'm like, pray, ask God, what do you mean, God? He says, just keep reading. Because he's going to list them for us. But they're in Jesus. Every spiritual blessing in Christ. All of our blessings are in Jesus. All of our blessings are in Jesus. The first blessing, for he chose us in him. He chose us. That's a spiritual blessing. That's a huge spiritual blessing. He didn't choose us in ourselves. He chose us in him. So it doesn't depend on how we act or what we do or what we say or what we've done. That isn't how he chose. He chose us in Jesus. That takes the pressure off. Because guess what? I've messed up a lot of stuff. I've screwed up a lot of things, a lot of relationships. I've hurt people, my children, my wife, in ways that are really deep and really painful. But my position isn't based on me. My position is based on me being in Jesus. And I just want to relieve you of that pressure. It isn't dependent on you and what you've done. You don't have to perform, okay? It's not about religion. It's not about here's a list of rules and this is how you got to do it so that you'll be in Jesus. No, Jesus paid the price. He chose us. He loves us. It's an important message. Real simple. Everyone probably knows it. Most. But we forget. For he chose us in him before the creation of the world. You know, before Genesis 1:1, he chose me in Jesus. That blew me away. I mean, I know he knew me. You know, I know one Psalm 139 where he knitted me together in my mother's womb and then went in the darkness when I was made. He knew me. He was with me. He knows me. I knew that. But he knew me even before that. He chose me before that. He chose me before I was ever created. Before the creation of time. Why did he choose me? To be holy and blameless in his sight. Again, that feels like, oh, man, I got to be holy and blameless in his sight. In Jesus. That's the only way we're going to be holy and blameless. We can't do it. The law was sent so that, to prove that we need a Savior. Because we can't. We got to rely on Jesus. And it's in him. It's in him. For he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us to be adopted. In love. The Father's love. The expression of his love. He's blessed us. He's chosen us. He's lavished us with love. Now he's going to adopt us. He wants us to be his children. He's adopted us. I don't know if you guys know a lot about adoption, if anyone's been adopted or tried to adopt a child, but it's difficult. It's difficult. It's time consuming. It's expensive. But in the Roman culture, it was different. The adopted child had more rights than the blood-born child. In the Roman culture, if your child was misbehaving or was being disobedient to God, you could put them to death. You could disown them. But if you adopted one, no. Once you adopted them, they're yours. And they have the rights to your inheritance, and there's nothing you can do. You can't put them to death. You can't disown them. They're yours. And Paul's the only one that speaks about adoption. I found that interesting. Just spoke to me that I think that he spoke about it just because he was ministering to the Gentiles. I don't know that that's the reason why he did it, but they weren't Jews. They weren't God's chosen people. They were kind of adopted in. They were grafted in. We're grafted in. We're kind of adopted in. And it's secure. Once he adopts us, we're his. It isn't based upon our performance. It's based on what Jesus has done. He adopted us in love. He determined beforehand that he was going to adopt us as children through Christ Jesus. Through Jesus. Again, it's all about Jesus. It's always in Jesus. Our adoption is in him. In accordance with his pleasure and will. That brings him pleasure. He did it to bring himself pleasure. We bring him pleasure. And it's in accordance with his will. It's what he desired. It's what he wants. I forget that. That he's chosen me. Well, first of all, he blessed me, that he chose me, that he loved me, that he adopted me. That's insane. And that through that, he gets pleasure out of that. He gets pleasure in me being his child. Because it's in Christ. Again, not about me. In love, he predestined us to be adopted as his sons through Jesus Christ in accordance with his pleasure and will to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us in the one he loves, in Jesus, the freedom of, he's accepted us. He's accepted us in Jesus, freely given us the grace, freely given what we don't deserve. He loves us. He's chosen us. He's blessed us. He's adopted us. He takes great pleasure in us. We bring him joy. Sometimes we forget. Verse 7, in him, here we go again, in him, that just means in him, going back to the blessings in Christ, that we were to be holy and blameless, be in him. It reminds me of John 15 when I say that, in him. You know, he's the vine, we're the branches. Apart from him, we can't do anything. I'm not going to bear fruit if I'm not in Jesus. You know, it's reiterated. Jesus even tells us, you got to be in me, you got to remain in me. How do we remain in him? Remember the word became flesh? Remain in him? Eat. Tony talked about that. Just taking time to stop. Spend some time with him. That's how you remain in him. That's how he speaks to us. This is how when I get in this, then I get reminded of who I am and the position that I have and all that he's done for me. Remaining in him. In him, we have redemption through his blood. We just sang that song. Through his blood, we've been redeemed. We will rejoice because he has overcome. He has overcome because he's sitting up in the heavenly realms, above authority, above powers, above all everything. He's already overcome. When he's singing that song, it just blew me, it just melted my heart. Because it's not just a song. It's a song that Matt wrote. It's a song that God laid on Matt's heart in 2012 or whatever, then he's singing it today, and then he's bringing the word and he's tying them together. You know, I can become an emotional guy. It breaks me down. God knew. God orchestrated all this stuff. And to tie those things together, this divine appointment. What is God trying to say to you? Don't miss it today. You're here for a reason. This word is brought for a reason. We sang those songs for a reason. Don't forget who you are in him. Don't forget who you are in him. He's chosen you. He's blessed you. He wants you. He loves you. He adores you. He treasures you. You bring him joy. Yeah, we stumble. Yeah, we fall. He loves us. And he's a forgiving God. We've been redeemed. You know what redeemed means? Paid a ransom to be bought back. He paid a price to get us back. I forget that. This is the foundation of our faith, but I forget it because I leak. If I'm not in the word, I leak. I forget. I'm a cracked cistern. But he's redeemed us. He's bought us back. You know, and there was like 60,000 slaves during the Roman Empire, I think, and they could be bought and sold. They were traded like furniture. But you know what else could happen? You could go and buy a slave and then set them free. And then they were free. That's what he's done. That's what Jesus did for us. I was enslaved to my sin. I was enslaved to my flesh. I was bound up by the law. When he bought me and paid the price for me, I'm set free from the law. I'm set free from the powers of my own flesh. I'm set free from the powers of this world because he redeemed me. Not because I was good, not because I performed in a certain way, but because he loved me, because he chose me, because for the beginning of time, it was his desire for me to be his child. And by me being his child, that brings him much joy. We forget that. Don't. Be reminded of that, who you are and whose you are. And your position. Yeah. And we're positioned up here, but we're living down here. But we've been given authority up there. So we have the authority to, that's what prayer is a lot of times, is bring it down on heaven, in heaven as it, on earth as it is in heaven. This just hit me. It's like when we pray, we have the power to bring heaven to earth through our prayer. So don't think that your prayers are weak or feeble or whatever. We got the power of Jesus. I'm sitting in him, with him, over, have authority over this stuff. Bring it down in faith. What it is that I'm struggling with, yeah. Call on his name. He can set me free from any issue I have. Any things that are going around, we can get set free. We have been. It's the already, but not yet. But we've been redeemed. He paid the price. Set me free. Wow. To be bonded out, man. He paid the price for me. But what was the price? Through his blood. Through his blood. I forget about that. Through his blood. He's beaten. Crown of thorns on his head. Spit on. Humiliated. Humbled. Broken for me. Why? Why? Because he predetermined it from before the creation of time that he wanted me to be his son. And he was going to do whatever it took to get us. He'd go to any extreme to get us and to get our hearts. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins in accordance to the riches of God's grace that he's lavished on us. Forgiveness. It's the greatest miracle in the world. It's a miracle. People are like, oh, I wish I could see a miracle. Huh? People think it's a miracle. You know, a lot of times I think the greatest miracle in the world is a transformed life. From who I was 12 years ago, if you knew me and you saw me today, you would be like, wow, that is insane, crazy. That's a miracle. But it's really not, I mean, it's really, this is just this is symbolic of the miracle that happened on the cross. That's the greatest miracle. It's just when I came to grips with what it was, how much he loved me, That's when I started to be transformed. It was his love for me. It wasn't that I've started focusing on him and what it is that he's done for me. And I dug into the scriptures. I got tired of people telling me what it said. I wanted to get in it and I wanted to hear what it said. Because for some reason, certain people were saying stuff that I just didn't think that was really right. And when I got in here, and it wasn't about being good enough. There was nowhere in that I found that. It was about that he came to rescue and save that was lost. And that he loves me. And that God's kindness leads me to repentance. When I recognized who I was and the sinful man that I was and then the price that he had to pay for me, that put me, like I said, he puts me in a vise of love. It's like a velvet vise that he just cranks down on me. And I was just like, I'm just secure in him. And I just love him. And when I'm in that vise, then I'm just walking in the spirit. And then that's when my life got transformed. When I understood how much he loved me. But to be forgiven is to be, I think the word means to cast off or to separate. You know, it says in the Psalms that he's taken our sins and separated them as far as the east is from the west. Doesn't remember them anymore. Makes me think of John the Baptist when he saw Jesus coming in his ministry saying, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. He takes it away. He takes away our sin. To be forgiven. Wow. What I deserve for what I've done? I'm not getting what I deserve. Thank God that he doesn't treat me as my sins deserve. Because I deserve death. And instead it went on Jesus. And when I recognize that, it changes my life. But it's God's working all these things out in our lives. But the true evidence of whether or not Christ is in my life is if I become like him. And I've never become more like him than when I forgive. I never become more like him until when I forgive. When I've been hurt deeply and wounded badly, and that I forgive somebody, truly forgive them, not bringing it back up, not throwing it in their face later. Really forgive them. You know, I've done a lot of things in my life. I've hurt my wife in really deep and just really deep ways that I'm just can't believe that I did. But you know what? She's forgiven me. Does that mean that she's just, oh, don't worry about it, honey. It's okay. I forgive you. No, it costs something. When she forgave me, it costs something. That means she took that pain on herself. But she received that pain, and I'm going to take that pain, and I'm going to shoulder that pain, and I'm going to let you go. There's something special about that. That's when I know that I'm loved. When she's forgiven me about something, she doesn't throw it in my face. She doesn't bring it back up. It's done. I forgive you. But that weight is still, she carried that weight. She went and gave it to Jesus. But that's evidence. I remember Paul saying, you know, I want to know Jesus and share in his sufferings and to become like him on the cross. Share in his sufferings. We do. We share in his sufferings. Paul shared in his sufferings. But to become like him in the Christ is humility and to be forgiving. God, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. So there was a price paid. It was the blood that was shed. Band, you can get in place if you want. We're going to do communion today. Like I say, we forget about what God's done. This is a great reminder that we have been redeemed. We have been forgiven. No matter where you're at, no matter what you're struggling with, no matter what you've done, he loves you. And he is way more willing to forgive you than what we are to come and confess our sin and repent. But 1 John 1:9 tells us if you're willing to go and ask, that he's more than willing to forgive you of all your sins and to purify you from all unrighteousness. Everything. There's nothing too far. So I just pray that you're just refreshed, that you're encouraged, and that you know that you're loved and cared for. And we're going to take time, and just, it tells us in the scriptures before we take the bread and the cup that we should reflect on ourselves and where we're at. If we're harboring bitterness or anger or something against our brother, that we would ask for forgiveness. If there's something that would separate us from Jesus and his love, just if there's a barrier there, that we would let that come down. So before we take part, I just ask that you just do that. If you're a visitor here, we do practice open communion. You don't have to be a member here. If you're a believer in Jesus, you're more than welcome to come and dine with us. They'll play a song, like I say, just kind of reflect a while and then come up as you feel led. Take it back to your seat and then we'll take part together.
I cannot stand.
Scripture tells us the night that he was going to be betrayed, he sat down with his 12. Yeah, even the one that was going to betray him, he sat down with him. He said, "This is my body. It's broken for you. Every time you eat of it, do this in remembrance of me." Then he took the cup and he blessed it. He said, this is the blood of the new covenant for the forgiveness of your sins. Every time you drink of it, do this in remembrance of me. Father, we just praise you. God, we just thank you for the price that you paid for us, God, that you, before the beginning of time, God, that you chose us. God, that you expressed your love for us. God, that you've adopted us, you've redeemed us. God, you've forgiven us. God, that we bring you joy through the pain of your son. Oh, God, may we not forget that. God, we just praise you and thank you for that. I just pray that your word would just marinate in the hearts of this flock, Lord, that they would be refreshed, that they would be encouraged, that they would walk with their heads held high, knowing who they are and their position in you and all that you've done for them. And then, God, as we walk out and into this dark world, God, that we'd just be a shining light, confident to share who it is that we are in you and just what you've done for us. And we'll just give you the praise and the glory in Jesus' name, amen. And it says in Scripture after the meal that they sang a hymn. So we're going to sing a hymn. Please stand.
Stand on your word. Stand on your word.
Amen. We are the church. And you know, the scriptures tells us the old man has been done away, and behold, all things have become new. So we are the church today. And Ken, I thank you for your words this morning that the Lord gave to you. And I'm going to read the prayer of Paul this morning. And Lord, I pray that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, that he may give to all of us your spirit of wisdom and of revelation and the knowledge of him. And Lord, I pray that the eyes of our hearts and our understandings may be enlightened so that you may know what is the hope of your calling, what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in us, and what is the surpassing greatness of his power toward us who believe, and we do believe. And finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. So go in the name of Christ today. You are set free, delivered by the blood of Jesus, and give him praise this week. Go in Jesus' name. Amen. Oh, yeah, and your communion cups. Make sure there are receptacles out there. You can throw those away, and they would appreciate it. Thank you.